Our final speaker is Sultana Kamal, a lawyer by training. She has been a human rights activist for more than 40 years. She participated in the Bangladesh Liberation War. She is now the executive director of Aino Shalish Kendra, one of the leading human rights organizations in Bangladesh. She's also the current chairperson of Transparency International Bangladesh, national chair of We Can End Violence Against Women, and convener of the campaign Bangladesh Rise Up to Resist, which works to oppose violence against religious and ethnic minorities and others. In 1996, she won the John Humphrey Freedom Award for human rights and for her opposition to fundamentalism. Please welcome Sultana.
Thank you, Peter. Can you hear me at the back? All right? Okay. Thank you very much. And I must thank the organizers of this conference for having me here. And it's indeed an honor for me to be able to speak in front of you about Bangladesh. We have to be very brief because it's only 8 to 10 minutes to talk about Bangladesh, which is a huge issue, particularly how secularism rose and fell in Bangladesh. Probably we shouldn't say fell, but then how it's disappearing from the minds of the people for many different reasons. So I'll just probably be a bit jumpy, so you have to forgive me, and you can probably ask me questions if there are clarifications needed. So Bangladesh actually came into being, as far as the world map is concerned, in 1971. But Bangladesh was actually built bit by bit since 1952, when we had our language movement, that we wanted our language to be recognized as one of the state languages. But that wasn't actually restricted only to the issue of recognition of language. It was a movement, a sacrifice by the people of Bangladesh, the then East Pakistan, to say that we reject the religion-based national identity and we want to be known as we are, to speak our own language, to practice our own culture, to be recognized as a respectable entity as we have been born. And we also had many, many movements over the decades of 50 and 60 to say that we want to see our country as a secular, democratic country where everybody, each individual, irrespective of their whatever identity they hold, to be equal before the law, to be respected as equal citizens of the country. So we had movements for cultural autonomy, we had movements for secular education, we had movements for economic freedom, we had movements for freedom of thought and conscience, and which culminated in our liberation war in 1971. And there we gave our slogan saying that the religion is for individuals and state is for all. And we said that we don't want to be identified as any particular religious sect or community. This country will belong to everyone who has earned it. And we did win a victory against the Pakistani occupation army in December 1971. And against, I would say, or not to the liking of the ruling party at that time, Awami League, because they always maintained that they will have religion as part of their whatever policies they have. But then they were kind of led to recognize secularism as one of the fundamental principles of Bangladesh, which was incorporated in our constitution. We had democracy, we had nationalism, we had secularism, we had socialism, as the four basic fundamental principles of Bangladesh. And we had definitely many, many questions and comments on the governance between 1972 and 1975, no doubt. But as many of you may be aware, that in 1975, our first elected president was killed with his entire family, except the two daughters, one of which is now the prime minister and is leading Awami League. Anyway, to cut a long story short, in 1975, the country was taken over by a military government. And the first thing they did was to strike off secularism from the constitution. And instead, they inscribed Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim on the top of the constitution and said, total and absolute faith in Allah will be the basic principle of all actions in Bangladesh. And that was the beginning of state-sponsored Islamization of Bangladesh in our country. And then the first general was also killed by another general, he was killed and the other general was somehow implicated in the whole affair. And when he came to power, what he did was that he declared Islam to be the state religion of Bangladesh. So that was, again, a reinforcement of the Islamization process of Bangladesh by these two military generals. So we can see a very clear connection between militarization. Oh, I'm so sorry. I have already spoken for 6 minutes. Okay. militarization, Islamization, and anti-democratic processes to be supported by the state itself. Anyway, I was supposed to talk about the fate of Bangladesh, fate of secularism in Bangladesh. It wasn't only a national phenomenon. I must also mention that it was definitely an international process that was working in Bangladesh, because by then the international politics also turned into some way, trying to kind of establish Islamic countries as opposed to the socialist bloc, which was still existent at that time. So the international communities also wanted to name Bangladesh as moderate Muslim country, which we protested because we never wanted our country to become a moderate Muslim country. We wanted to see a secular Bangladesh. But then by then, there has been an invasion in the education system, in the medical system, in the banking, insurance, land ownership, everything, where a total Islamization process was working. You go anywhere, you will find a person who is known to be a Islamic person to lead any private sector or government organization. And then the other thing that has happened in Bangladesh, which is very significant, that these two military generals, in fact, brought back the anti-liberation war Islamic forces, the political Islamic forces, who were actually defeated in 1971 and had to leave the country, and reinstated them everywhere, in administration, in the army, in civil society, in education, everywhere. So this was kind of an invasion by the Islamic fundamentalists in Bangladesh. And that was safeguarded by the then governments to the extent that now when we have the Awami League-led government back in power, who in fact very legitimately can claim that they have provided leadership to our liberation war, is now totally in a nervous position to bring back secularism or to promote secularism in Bangladesh, even though we have brought back secularism to our constitution, but then the state religion is still in place. We still have Islam as the state religion of Bangladesh. So this is an anomaly we are living with. And the secularist forces are becoming more and more a minority in Bangladesh. So we now witness attack on the Hindu minorities, demolition of temples, attack on the hill tracts people, and attack on the secular people. The atmosphere has deteriorated so much. Let me just give you one personal example that my private life in Bangladesh is no secret. And people know that I have married a person who was not born to Islam and he has not converted. So I was followed by an army soldier, an ordinary army soldier in one of the shops in my husband's hometown, and he could have the courage and to come and ask me that what religion do you follow? So this is the atmosphere we live in. So you have to have a particular religion, and that is Sunni Muslim religion. And the way everything is progressing in Bangladesh, as if this country now belongs only to Sunni Muslim men, because all other people have somehow or other less rights than the Sunni Muslim men in Bangladesh. And that is being promoted by society, the state, and every legal provisions of the country. And we have very tragic examples of women being subject to violence in the name of religion. In 1993 only, we had 42 cases of fatwa, which is, according to Bangladesh law, illegal, but subject to fatwa, where many of them either committed suicide or killed by the severe punishment given to them in the name of fatwa. And people in Bangladesh now can almost do anything in the name of Islam. So in Bangladesh, it's the Islamic fundamentalism, militarization, patriarchy, which is working together. And as we have mentioned in our original statement that we are going to say or speak about secularism as a precondition for democracy, I just want to finish my whatever words I had to sort of deliver here to say that this is how we can definitely very clearly state that without secularism, there will not be any democracy in our society. But even though the path to secularism has been thwarted by many historical facts in Bangladesh, our hopes and aspirations will take us to that point where we will definitely see our dream come true, a secular Bangladesh. Thank you very much.